Martinez. Professor Antonio Martinez is an eminent interventional radiologist in Europe and Spain, and actually he helped us much in establishing the technique of radio embolization here in Egypt maybe 5 years ago or more, and actually he's still helping us up till now in doing difficult cases. I would like to thank him and to introduce him. He will speak about the role of interventional radiology in management of colorectal cancer.
Thank you, Professor Eldori, for your kind words. Thank you also for the organizers of the meeting for the kind invitation. I try to be brief, as it's already 1:30. After all these lectures, I guess you're all dying for a cup of coffee or tea. So at the initiation of the treatment and during the treatment sequence, we will have to actually make decisions, okay? So we'll have to start by deciding, shall we go for a curative approach, if the patient is suitable for that, or if not, we'll just have to try to make him or her live as long as possible with a good quality of life, and hopefully make it a surgical candidate. In the other end of the scenario, there will be patients with very advanced disease in which palliation will be their only hope, with no hope for cure. So we shouldn't forget about this. So the different specialties have different techniques that can be applied to these patients. Surgery can be active, resecting the primary tumor, obviously, and those patients that are suitable for that, and also removing the liver metastases and the lung metastases as well. Chemotherapy and biological agents have a role, even with a curative intent as prior and after surgery, and also throughout the whole spectrum of disease, either in the curative setting, in the survival prolongation setting, and also in the palliative setting. Radiotherapy is used mostly in rectal tumors, because radiotherapy in the liver, external beam radiotherapy, it's not possible to apply external beam radiotherapy to the liver. I will talk more about this tomorrow in my talk on radioembolization. So how does interventional radiology fit, you know, among all these different treatment options and among the scale of disease? Well, for the primary tumor, interventional radiology can offer colonic stenting. As an adjunct to surgery, we have radiofrequency ablation, microwave ablation, and cryoablation, which are three different varieties of the same concept or idea. Portal vein embolization is another technique that we will be discussing. And then we have all the complications that happen when a patient has surgery. For example, a patient can bleed after the surgery, or some patients may have a metastasis compressing the bile ducts, and we will have to work on that. You know, interventional radiology can actually help patients in that respect as well. As far as chemotherapy and biological agents are concerned, I think port insertion, as simple as it may seem, I think it's a very important issue that we shouldn't forget about. It's nothing fancy, nothing, you know, not a new technique, nothing special, but I think it's very important for the quality of life of patients. And then we have all the arterially directed techniques, which have just been mentioned. Let's start by colonic stents. Colonic stents have two main indications in this setting. One of them is as a bridge to surgery. We have these patients, not often, but sometimes we get patients with a colonic tumor. They present with a colonic obstruction. Okay, the options are to do an emergency surgical decompression, or the alternative is to do a colonic stent and delay the surgery until the patient is in a better condition. By doing this, we can lower the mortality rate, the surgical mortality rate of the compression. The patients will have a shorter hospital stay, and also, and very importantly, the colostomy rate after emergency surgical decompression that cannot be reconverted is quite high as compared to the treatment plan starting with colonic stent and planned surgery. In the palliative setting, okay, the colonic stent, is it an option for the colostomy? It has a similar mortality rate and a shorter hospital stay, but there's one problem. As the tumor responds to therapy, and if it's not removed and responds to therapy, we will have a displacement of the stent and even perforation of the colon. So I wouldn't advise to use a colonic stent in a palliative setting in a patient that is planned to have a relatively long term of chemotherapy. Port insertion, again, you know, is not just putting in a port, it's also keeping it working. How often do I get patients in the clinic coming, you know, after 4 or 5 cycles of chemotherapy, saying, oh God, you know, why wasn't this offered to me before? And the question to that is that initially, sometimes the oncologists, they think, okay, I'll do a short course of therapy, maybe 4 or 5 sessions, that will be it. I think the patient can, you know, can put up with that. Then plans change because the disease changes, and you find this patient who has had 4, 5, 6 cycles of chemotherapy, you know, with horrible veins, and then they ask you to insert a port, okay? I think a port should be inserted, you know, should be the first procedure to be done to any oncological patient receiving chemotherapy. Even if you plan to do a short treatment, I mean, things can change. And it only takes 10 minutes to put a port in the cephalic vein. So ports can be inserted surgically, and that's an option. The other option is to do it by a percutaneous puncture in the angio room. The advantage of doing that is that obviously you don't need to open a theater, and then you can actually see the position of the port and the position of the cannula before the patient leaves the room. And also, port insertion is not a standard technique. You have to tailor it to each individual patient. If you see in the slide top left, you will see that the capsule, the port itself, is placed in an awkward location. This is because this female patient has big breasts. If you place that port in the usual position, she will end up with the cannula hanging up in the jugular vein or somewhere else. It's just a matter of time for that to happen. So you have to be imaginative, and you have to tailor the treatment to each patient. Complications can happen during you know, the period of life of the patient, and the cannula may migrate to the jugular vein or may develop a sheath of fibrin, as in these slides here, and we are able to treat that and make the port and make it back to a working condition. After surgery, complications can happen. One of them is hemorrhage, as in this case. You can see on the CT scans, the reconstructions, you can see that there is a pseudoaneurysm from one of the branches of the internal iliac artery with active bleeding. This patient, you can see has just had surgery. You can see it. You can see the staples there. And in this setting, you can either go in and reoperate the patient. Imagine to try to find the source of bleeding in a patient who has just been operated a few hours before. It's almost impossible. So what we can offer is do an arteriogram by a transfemoral approach, detect the source of bleeding, and then we can treat it just by placing coils. It doesn't take long. Another advice for those radiologists present here. I don't know what you do in your normal practice, but nowadays I never do an angiogram in order to treat a gastrointestinal hemorrhage without having done first a CT angiogram. The CT angiogram actually points you to the point to the source of bleeding, then you go in straight and you treat the patient. Some people will say, okay, you're losing time doing the CT. That's not true in most of the time. You lose time by trying to find the source of bleeding using angiography. So it's much quicker to do the CT scan and then go and treat. We don't do angiography for diagnostic purposes in the 21st century. Portal vein embolization is another technique that we can offer. Not only us, the surgeons can do portal vein ligation as well, which are, you know, is the two visions of the same technique. Usually in the patient who has a 2-stage hepatectomy that has surgery to treat, you know, to treat the small metastases, at that time he or she can have the portal vein ligated at the same surgical time. Now, for those patients that are not having surgery, I think that percutaneous portal vein embolization is a much nicer technique. In this study published a few years ago, 2002, you can compare, you know, the rates of morbidity between the two procedures. They are actually the same. The increase in volume of the future liver remnant is higher with the percutaneous portal vein embolization than with ligation. And also the hospital stay obviously is less. The number of resections performed are almost the same. Now, why is the increase in volume higher with portal vein embolization as opposed to ligation? There are many reasons for that, but one of them could be, you can see 3 different cases that can happen. On the left-hand side, you can see an arterioportal shunt. This is not common in metastasis from colorectal cancer. It's fairly common in patients with HCC. In metastatic colorectal cancer, though, some patients may have had a biopsy before, and a liver biopsy can actually be a cause of an arterioportal shunt. So you can have an arterioportal shunt, you can have shunts between different branches of the porta, and you can have shunts or communications between the portal vein and the hepatic vein. If you just ligate the portal vein at its origin, you're actually closing the inflow of blood into the portal vein, but you've got other taps open elsewhere that are going to refill the portal vein from a different place. So by ligating the portal vein, you actually, you're doing nothing. The patient, you know, the portal vein remains open, in fact. So the way to deal with this is by doing portal vein embolization. You can actually go in and catheterize the connections, the shunts, and coil them, close them with a coil. That's one option. Or, which, as you can see here, this is a coil. It's just like a, you know, like a wire with hairs to make it more thrombogenic. And if you can place that inside the portal vein here, and then you can see that occludes the portal vein, but the distal branches remain open. If we have communications distally, those branches will be full of blood. Okay? So the alternative is to do embolization. There are many embolic agents that we can use. We can use different size of particles, different kinds of particles. We can also use liquid agents. I did a study, I'm not using this in clinical practice, but you can use glue, or you can use an embolic agent called Onyx. The trouble with glue, or the advantage first of liquid agents, is that you actually fill all the portal branches with the material. So you're actually closing all the portal branches. If you use glue for this purpose, the trouble is that glue, when it becomes solid, is really hard, and it's really difficult to cut. So that's adding difficulty maybe to the surgeon later at the time of operation. So a way to overcome this is to use an agent called Onyx that is actually like plasticine. It has that consistency, and you can inject it and filling all the portal vein. The only problem with that is that it's quite expensive to use in this setting. This agent was developed to treat aneurysms inside the brain. And usually the quantity that you get in a bottle is about 2 or 3 millimeters, which is enough to treat an aneurysm. To fill the portal vein, you need in the order of 200 or 300 milliliters. So in clinical use, it's not really, we cannot use it because it's too expensive. One day maybe the price will come down. We've got the ablative treatments, radiofrequency, cryoablation, microwave. We've heard about these a few minutes ago. Basically, the outcomes are similar to all of them. Maybe microwave is the newcomer. Maybe the outcome is a bit better, just because two facts. One is that you can apply it to lesions which are close to the draining vessels. All these techniques act by heating the lesion in a way. So if they are close to the portal vein or the hepatic veins, these veins have a cooling effect, and that means that the treatment is not effective. Okay. Microwave, in a way, can overcome this. With microwave, we can treat also larger lesions, and also we can shape, in a way, the necrosis that we're going to achieve. Okay? The best outcomes with these techniques, as expected, is when we have small lesions and in a limited number, and obviously when the disease is not too advanced. Now, what about radioembolization? And I think I'll finish with this. We've just heard radioembolization uses yttrium-90 as a pure beta emitter. Yttrium-90 has a very short range of radiation, so only travels between a beam of 2.5 millimeters, a maximum of 11 millimeters, and has a half-life of 2.5 days. For those of you that know a bit of radiotherapy or radioactivity, 10 half-lives equal to no activity, by definition, okay? So that means that 26 days after the administration of the spheres, there's no activity within the liver anymore. That's important because some of these patients will be downstaged and they will subsequently undergo an hepatic resection. And it's, some surgeons are afraid of touching these patients because they think that they're going to receive radiation from the cell procedure. And that is not true. After 3 weeks, there is no radiation left. Now, to do a CERT procedure, it's a two-step procedure. We have, in the first step, we do an angiogram to identify the vessels supplying the liver. I don't know if you know, but the normal anatomy, the normal hepatic arterial anatomy in the liver, is only present in about 45% of people. So most of us will have an anatomical variant in the arterial supply of the liver. And we have to have a map of that before we go in. And then we need to occlude all the arteries that actually originating from the hepatic artery, but affecting other organs, such as the stomach or the duodenum. We don't want any radiation going away from the liver. And after having done this, we inject albumin, macroaggregates of albumin, labeled with technetium 99, and the patient goes for a nuclear medicine scan. With this nuclear medicine scan, we can do several things. One, we see how much shunting there is to the lung, and two, we see if there's any extrahepatic deposition. If the shunting is fine, if there's not too much shunting and no extrahepatic deposition, then we can treat the patient. So the patient comes for the treatment and has the treatment, and then we can confirm the distribution also using nuclear medicine techniques. So you can see that this is a truly multidisciplinary procedure. You cannot do this procedure on your own. You need the collaboration of the whole team. Now, where do we integrate radioembolization in the treatment of patients with metastatic colorectal disease? We can use it, you know, in the worst cases, patients with chemo-refractory disease, with N lines of chemotherapy, or maybe we can use it in the second line, first line, or even, you know, at the beginning of the disease, okay? So the answer to this, we still don't know. We've got reports showing, you know, complete response in the salvage setting. You see on the PET scan, you see the metastases and how actually they disappear following radioembolization. And we also have reports of a very good response in a less advanced setting, but patients having this treatment and then undergoing surgery. So there are, you know, in order to answer this question, there has been lots of studies, well, a fair number of studies being done, but the most important study trying to answer this question in the first line setting is happening right now. We can see the results, you know, on the past. We knew, I don't know if you can read this. I think no, because I cannot read it from here. But anyway, we've got, you know, in all these settings I've mentioned before, it has been shown that the median survival of patients actually improves by using this technique. Not on its own, but using it as a first line treatment with chemotherapy, also in the palliative setting, or in the second or third line, or even in the consolidation of first line setting. So this is the kind of results you get as a first line combination therapy compared to the chemotherapy and biologic agents on their own. This is the delay in disease progression and the overall survival. You see that there is some improvement. Now we need to demonstrate this. And for this purpose, there are a few studies going on now. There are basically two studies which are similar. One is the Foxfire trial, which was started by the University of Oxford a few years ago. And they were combining in one arm oxaliplatin and a modified chemotherapy, and in the other arm the same treatment with Seresphias. And the primary endpoint of the study was the overall survival of the patient. A similar study, but not quite the same, is the SIRFLOX study. This is a randomized, also controlled study, which has been undertaken throughout the world, in America, in Europe, and also in Asia. And basically, it tries to compare the role of Seresphias in the first-line treatment in combination with FOLFOX, plus minus a biological agent. That's left to the election of the investigator. And there's been, the patient recruitment has finished, the study has been closed now, and now we are actually reading the results of the study. And that's what I've been doing most of my time for the last year. I've actually been looking at thousands of CT scans, baseline and follow-up scans, applying the RECIST criteria in order to assess response. Hopefully, October, we will get some preliminary results. Maybe at the end of the year, we will know, you know, if there's any role of combining radioembolization with the, you know, chemotherapy and as a first-line treatment for metastatic colorectal cancer. The two studies, the SIRFLOX and the FOXFIRE, have been combined now, and a new study has been launched, which is called the FOXFIRE Global Trial, which is basically pooling the data from both patients and recruiting new patients in order to keep on investigating on this pathway. Thank you very much for your attention.
Professor Dr. Antonio, thank you very much for very practical and elaborative presentation. We have a few minutes for a few questions. If anybody have any hot topic to be discussed, so please. Yes, please, Professor Mohammed Lutfi. So the question to Professor Dr. Antonio, yes. Would you like to move this mic?
Is there any rule for transarterial chemoembolization in bilateral hepatocellular carcinomas involving both halves of liver, transarterial TACE?
Yes. For bilobar lesions.
Yeah. As far as I know, there is no scientific data proving, you know, the real benefit of doing that. In the past, many years ago, we were doing a lot of intra-arterial chemotherapy for these patients, and on and off, you know, I know that there are some people that support that. We were doing it for a while, then we stopped doing it. I've never done TACE for metastatic colorectal cancer as such. So we just moved from doing intratracheal chemotherapy to radioembolization. We started doing radioembolization back in 2003, so it's 11 years ago now, and we skipped the TACE, you know, the TACE era of...
I have a question to Dr. Mahmoud El-Metheni. Dr. Mahmoud El-Metheni, if you allow me, our Egyptian patient with hepatocellular carcinoma is very unlucky person, because when he presented with a child classification B or C, we as a medical oncologist usually deny any possibility for transplantation. And again, if I faced a very asymptomatic patient with a small lesion and I send it to a very pioneer surgeon like you, you sometimes telling us that active hepatitis C as well as a little bit cirrhosis as well as his general condition rather than asymptoms of his presentation, still you are reluctant. So can you comment on this, please?
You mean cirrhotic patients with small tumors?
With small tumor, asymptomatic, but still have active hepatitis.
Yeah. There have been multiple studies over and over, and they are repeatedly comparing liver transplantation with hepatic resection for early, and by the word early, they mean small HCCs, less than 3 centimeters. And the results have been 50-50, sometimes in favor of resection, sometimes in favor of transplantation. The idea behind favoring transplantation over resection is that you're not treating only, as I said, the tumor, but you're treating the underlying liver disease at the same time, especially if this patient could be treated either in the pre-transplant setting or the post-transplant setting by the antiviral therapies and turned negative, then this would achieve the best results. Because recurrence following resection for HCC in cirrhotic liver, it's almost 100%. From 3 to 5 years, it's almost 100% recurrence if you do resection for these cases. But this doesn't mean that we will do transplant for all cases. There are still some cases that will benefit from resection, cases with small HCCs, where we can do limited resections, or when the hepatic reserve is well preserved, we can do even formal resections, extended resections in these cases, child days and so. But the concern is always about the recurrence rate. And nowadays, with the new agents or the DDAs, the direct acting antivirals drugs that's appearing this year and onwards, and the possibility that will evolve to turn, well, it's very expensive medication, but when it become available really all over the world and especially in our country, if you can turn these patients before transplantation negative HCV, because I'm speaking about HCV because it's the main cause of hepatocellular carcinoma in our country, 90-95%. So if we can turn them HCV negative before transplant and then transplanting them, then we would have achieved the best results. Until then, resection will still have got its place in some cases, but again, it's a decision that we make on a case-by-case decision in a multidisciplinary clinic that we all discuss it, taking into account the age of the patient, the comorbidity, his heart, his kidneys, and everything, and then we take the decision in the light of all these components.
Any further question? If no, so thank you very much for attending this very important scientific session. And now we have a coffee break for 15 minutes. Thank you.